if we can create alternatives, then psychiatry will think, actually, we're being made redundant here, we need to change. You know, so that's why I really like the Hearing Voices Network creating self-help groups. So welcome, everybody, and I extend that welcome to any voices here, because there are bound to be voices here too. Given that about 4% of the population hears voices. So they're very welcome too, to this talk. So mindfulness is really an approach to living that's rooted in Buddhist practices. It's about trying to be present, really, to be with what is there at the present moment, what is here. And noticing, I guess, what's going on in the here and now. And that can be quite a good counterbalance to our tendency to be projecting into the future or going over the past. So different parts of ourselves will be very preoccupied with the past, and there'll be parts of ourselves that are kind of pushing to control or achieve things in the future. Particularly in the West, where there's a big emphasis on intellectual thinking. And so there's an idea that mindfulness could be helpful for us to just balance us a bit, to bring us back more into a grounded awareness. But you can find mindfulness in all walks of life and different cultural traditions, and it's being used a lot in different therapeutic approaches, stress management. Even the American Army have been experimenting with mindfulness. Mindful soldiery. It's an interesting concept. I guess I'm trying to bring together in this talk in skills and thinking and experiences of using mindfulness, and how that we might apply that to hearing voices. So parts of ourselves or parts of the universe that are talking to us, and perhaps still mindfully engage with life as well. So how can we have a balance? And that's very much influenced by the Hearing Voices movement, which has been around for about 25 years. Started in Holland with a psychiatrist called Maris Rom and his assistant researcher, Sandra Escher. His first teacher, really, was a voice hearer called Patsy Haig, and she really challenged him about his approach to helping people. He was a traditional social psychiatrist, and he was just using medication. Patsy Haig really challenged him with this and said, "You're not really interested in the content of my experience. For me, it's very real, and you're not really interested in that reality. I'd like to meet people who live harmoniously with their voices. Why can't you introduce me to anyone like that?" And she'd read a book by Julian Jayne, and Julian Jayne was arguing that voice hearing is essentially something that we all used to do a few thousand years ago. And she found this really liberating idea that there could be different ways to experience consciousness, and that it didn't have to be an abnormality to hear voices. They did a TV program about hearing voices, and Patsy Haig talked about her experience, and Maris Rom talked about his experience of helping people who hear voices. And they asked people to contact the program who heard voices, and over 800 people contacted the program. And about 40% of those had never used psychiatric services. There was a group of people living in the community who were managing to live harmoniously with their voices and not seeking help. And they were interested in how were they doing this, and could we learn anything from that? One of the main differences was that the people who were living with their voices and coping and getting on with their lives had more of a dialogue with their voices. They had more equal relationship. There was much less fear involved. Whereas the people who were struggling, granted, their voices were often more hostile, but also they were using different strategies to deal with their voices. They were trying to ignore them all the time. They were frightened to assert themselves with the voices, to negotiate. They either did what the voices said, or they tried to push them away. And yet the people living in the community with their voices without the use of psychiatry tended to be negotiating with their voices, arranging to converse with their voices at a convenient time. It was a relationship that wasn't like that of a bully and a victim, but more like a friend or a colleague, where you have choices in that relationship. And they had a story about why their voices were there that made sense to them. Whereas the people who were struggling didn't have a sense of why the voices said what they said. They may have been told it was because it was a mental illness. So when you don't understand why something's happening, it's a lot more frightening. They also found that the people living with their voices in the community without support had other people they could talk to about their voice hearing experience. So there was an acceptance of their voice hearing amongst friends or family, and often they had quite spiritual understandings of what was going on. So that other people respected, so their understandings were respected. Well, what if people could learn that confidence? So people who are struggling, okay, the voices are often more mean, more nasty, more aggressive, but what if they could learn that confidence to set boundaries with their voices? They could negotiate, they could choose whether to listen or not. And what if they could find meaning in the experience and create a story that made sense of what was going on? And what if they could find a community of people who would respect what they were going through, where they could talk freely about the experience? Because in our society, voice hearing is a very taboo experience, and often people get very judgmental or very frightened. That's where the Hearing Voices movement was born, really. The idea to set up self-help groups, conferences, meeting points, which would be safe spaces for people to talk about their experiences of voice hearing and then be accepted and learn ways to live with the voices and get on with their lives. So this very much fits with a mindfulness attitude, because in mindfulness, acceptance is one of the key kind of principles, really. So mindfulness has been used with pain. What they found is that people practicing this daily become less preoccupied by their pain. Pain becomes more manageable. And the thinking is that there's pain and then there's our thoughts, our resistance to pain. We might have a pain, a really nasty back pain, and then we have the thoughts, which are, why is this happening to me? I wish this wretched pain would go away. And all these kind of thoughts are resisting the actual experience. And the thinking is these thoughts actually make the pain a lot more painful. So that fits nicely with voice hearing too. Because society thinks voice hearing is an illness, or some parts of society think voice hearing is a sign that you are evil or possessed. You know, the media presents voice hearing as immoral, as dangerous. People who hear voices are very dangerous. So this creates a whole atmosphere of resistance to the experience, and people who hear voices wish they hadn't heard voices. I'm very interested in this, not because I hear voices, but because when I was 18, I was psychotic, and I had a bit of a meltdown or an awakening to alternative ways of seeing the world. And I believed I had all kinds of powerful beliefs. I believed I was a spy, and I believed I was in a battle between good and evil, and not much has changed, really. No. Perhaps I hold it more lightly. It's a good metaphor for life. But now I'm interested, actually, in not battling with evil, but having mindful dialogues with evil, with demons, because they have feelings too. But I'll come on to that, okay? So I had all these powerful experiences, which I didn't sleep, and I was quite... behaving quite strangely and impulsively, and so I ended up being given a diagnosis of schizophrenia. And I went through the psychiatric system. I managed to extricate myself from the psychiatric system after about a year, and focus on quite holistic strategies to find well-being. And I guess I became interested in voice hearing because I wanted to help people who were also given the label of schizophrenia. And not everyone who gets that label hears voices, but many do. And so I, for the last 15 years, I've been working with voice hearing and been running hearing voices groups the last 12 years, every week. So it's very relevant, really, the idea of, about mindful approaches to pain. So using that with voice hearing, if we can find ways to perhaps accept an experience, it changes. It's not giving in, like, I hear voices, therefore I've got to do what they say. It's not this kind of passive acceptance. It's an active acceptance. It's like, oh, hello. Hello, my old friend. Wondering why you're here. Can we talk later? Because I'm giving a talk right now. but I'm interested in what you've got to say. But perhaps this isn't the right time. In a hearing voices approach, we would ask, how many voices are you hearing? How old are they? Are they male or female? When did they start? And all these are clues, actually. Important life experiences and important dilemmas and problems in people's lives. The Hearing Voices movement now is looking at voices really as having meaningful messages that we can learn from. Going back to mindfulness, it's a similar approach. So I came across mindfulness about 10 years ago. My partner gave me a book about anger. She thought I might benefit from it. Okay. And I was doing quite a lot of campaigning about hopeful approaches to mental health and saying diagnoses like schizophrenia are meaningless and we need to use less medication and more compassionate approaches. But all this campaigning was taking a toll on me. I was upsetting colleagues. I was getting lots of letters from families across the country asking for help. So I was feeling quite overwhelmed. And I was Mr. Nice Guy in my daily life, but at home, at least once a month, I would kind of explode in anger. She got me this book called Anger, Buddhist Wisdom for Cooling the Flames by Thich Nhat Hanh. And I found it really helpful, actually, because it's a real gentle approach to anger. I mean, he talked about anger being like potatoes. And that if you eat potatoes raw, they're not very good for you. But if you cook them with awareness, if you notice you're angry, and then you do a mindful activity, go walking with the dog and really notice the environment, notice your footsteps, notice your breath for 20 minutes, and then you look into your anger. What was I angry about there? Actually, I'm quite tired, aren't I? And I was feeling a bit defensive, and start to step back, because you've created this mindfulness energy that you can then look at the pain, but from a more understanding perspective. You step back from the overwhelm. So you use mindfulness to step back. Oh, maybe there's another way to address this. Actually, I might need to apologize. Yeah, there was this idea that, like potatoes, if you cook potatoes in hot water for 20 minutes, then they're nourishing. So the same with anger. It's like a raw potato. So you've got to cook it, and then you can learn from it. You can turn it to wisdom. I really like this idea. So it wasn't about feeling bad about anger and guilty and trying not to get angry. It was just saying you've got to acknowledge it. He talked about saying, hello, anger, my old friend, which is nice. So rather than resenting your anger, or feeling ashamed about your anger, finding a different way to welcoming it, but not just becoming a slave either and just letting it take you over. And I think you can apply the same with angry voices, same approach. It's like we might need to step back from the experience of a voice is being really angry. Can we support people to go for a walk, maybe talk with someone about the experience, maybe focus on the breath, or do some exercise to try and release some of that agitation? And then, when you're calmer, understand why is this voice saying you're disgusting, you're stupid, what's going on there? But we can't do that when we're overwhelmed. We need to calm down and create a more grounded energy. But it seemed to make sense to me that rather than trying to get rid of the experience or wishing it wasn't there, take the same approach as you take to anger. Try and find ways to welcome it. Now, that's not for me to tell all voice hearers you need to welcome your voices, because that could be quite patronizing. But I might have to take that approach as a supporter. So I always say to people, please tell your voices, I'm not trying to get rid of them. Yeah? I'm trying to help you live with them and learn from them. If they're really angry with you, there must be a reason for that. How can we create enough safety to learn that lesson? They do this in like Buddhist monasteries. You breathe in for one step and breathe out for the next step. And breathe in for one step. Breathe out for the next step. I did this on a retreat with about 60 people for a week. We did this. We do sitting meditation, then we do mindful walking. You get quite competitive about it. Who can walk the most gently? But I could do that. If I've got a lot going on in my mind, I might do 20 minutes mindful walking at night time in the kitchen. And then I can often settle again. And I might also write down what I'm concerned about. So I let that part have a little bit of a say. And then I say, we'll talk about it in the morning. And then do some mindful walking. And that part feels acknowledged. And I get some calming activity. And then I can go to sleep usually. If you're focusing on your breath and your steps and your balance, the thoughts tend to move more to the back of your mind. So it just gives you a bit of space. But it's not about trying to distract forever. You will need to come back to those things if they are important. So when I was in the monastery, they gave us a piece of paper that talked about mindful activity. So we'd have, you're paying to be there, but you end up working. So you do mindfulness meditation. And so they might get you to chop vegetables. So you're doing it's only an hour, and it's actually quite nice. So you might have to chop vegetables, or you might be cleaning the men's toilet. I seem to get that quite a lot. And you say, oh, thank you very much. But whatever you're doing, there was this kind of, these five steps. So step one was do one thing at a time. Step two was focus your mind fully on it. Step three was, if you get distracted, which you will, bring your mind back to what you were focusing on. Step four was, repeat step three several hundred thousand times. So there was a real nice acknowledgement of how it's a constant process when you're trying to do something mindfully of getting distracted, coming back to the object of attention. Step five was, if your mind keeps getting distracted by something, pay it some attention. It may be trying to tell you something. People can beat themselves up for getting distracted. But if something's keeping distracting you, then we need to dialogue with it, basically. And that might be at that time, or it might be we can make an appointment to dialogue with that part. Say if it was keeping me up about giving this talk, and I was going over it in my head, I could say to that part, thanks a lot, acknowledge it, thanks a lot. I will give this more attention in the morning, but right now other parts of me want to get some sleep. And then that part will relax because it knows it's going to get a dialogue later. If we acknowledge parts of ourselves that we appear to be in battle with, they relax. If we say, thanks. I know what you're trying to do, you're trying to help. So this idea, I think, is really important. And I think sometimes, perhaps, mindfulness can be used to repress stuff. I'm not an expert on this, okay, but I reckon that people have used meditation practices and mindfulness to suppress things and to try and be in the present moment. And just like medication, if you keep suppressing something by whatever technique, it will come up bigger and bigger. So you do get, you get big bust-ups sometimes on retreats, and people suppress and suppress, and then there's a huge row at the end of the retreat, okay? There's a Zen monastery that I have links with, and sometimes they contact me to talk about these things. They've got a lot of wisdom, really, about these kind of things, because they do a lot of meditation. And then I think we're learning in the Hearing Voices movement, some of the things we're learning, I think they can learn from too, so it's nice cross-fertilization going on. Which brings me to voice dialogue. So in the Hearing Voices movement, one of the approaches people have found useful is the idea of dialoguing with voices. So if a voice is persistent and seems to have a strong message, and even if that's a really uncomfortable message, many people who hear voices have been willing to try and dialogue with that voice or be supported to dialogue with that voice. And we've learned from an approach in couple counseling called voice dialogue. So there was a Jungian psychologist called Hallan Sidra Stone in the late 60s, early 70s. And they came up with this model that we all have different parts. In a way, we all have different voices speaking to us. You know, you might have your competitive side, like I was talking about in the monastery when I was doing the walking. And you might have your very caring side. And you might have your playful child and your vulnerability. And these are all different parts, and they come out at different times. They come to the front at different times. And the idea of voice dialogue is that we become a good team manager of all these parts. So we create this space between parts that where we operate from, ideally, on a good day. So that, you know, if I'm shopping, I might have an impulsive part that wants to buy the mustard jumper, but because it's my favourite colour, I've got mustard trousers on. But then my rational side might be, well, you've got enough jumpers, you know. And my green side might be like, you know, what about the environment? You don't need to consume all the time. I wait for next winter and promise myself the mustard jumper. So it's like a good team manager who makes everyone feel heard. But a less confident team manager, let's not be judgmental about it, a less confident team manager might let a couple of personalities dominate in the team. The loudest voices, and doesn't listen to the shyer members of the team. People who aren't listened to in the team will rebel against the team, will have a mutiny, they will disrupt and work against the team because they don't feel heard, they don't feel they're part of this team. So that happens in teams, and it also happens in our psyche, according to voice dialogue ideas, that if we allow just a couple of parts of ourselves to dominate, other parts will get pissed off and they will sabotage stuff. And so we need to actually create time to listen to all our parts and give them a role in our lives. So for example, I have a meditative part that's probably quite close to the front here because of this talk. But I also have a part that likes to do martial arts, you know, that likes to let out play fight and spar even. So that's like yin and yang, see? That it's quite healthy in a way, I like to think. But that's been helpful to me. So the part that likes to be really peaceful, but then the part that likes to play fight and stuff. I've grown up in quite an aggressive society or world, really. And so there's part of me that likes that, so it plays with that. And it can be an outlet for me. So this is the idea that we become like this good team manager, and we honour our different energies. And the idea is that if we don't, if we, to survive, say we go to a very repressive school where freedom of expression is not encouraged, and we might suppress our rebel or our free spirit or our fighting spirit, we might have to suppress those, then if we really suppress them, then they, and they're natural to us, they can come back in a destructive way. So whatever we suppress that's natural to us, it will come back in a rebellious way. So priests who are told to be celibate can have really sexual dreams, for example. So what we suppress can come back to haunt us. You know, you make it stronger in our unconscious. If I suppress my anger, I might keep meeting angry people. I'm almost subconsciously attracted to them. And they develop this chair approach. So they actually ask couples to identify different parts of themselves. So to help couples get on with each other better, to learn about the different parts of each other. So if I've got a really irritating part of my partner, then that's just a part of them that's useful to know. You know, it's just a part of them. It's a defensive part or something. And then it's not like them I don't like. It's just a part of them that I'm struggling with. We can then interview different parts of our partners or friends. So if I wanted to, somebody here who's done voice dialogue could interview one of my parts, say my meditator or my pleaser, the part that likes to keep everyone happy. I could sit here, so this would be the whole of me, my centre, trying to be my, and then I could sit here to be my pleaser, and somebody could interview my pleaser, and I'd be like, "Hi," you know, and what do you want to know? How are you feeling? I think this is going quite well, don't you? So, and you get to know that energy that's really all about keeping the other person happy isn't about meeting my needs, it's all about meeting other people's needs. And that could be really useful for me, particularly if I'm having trouble with that part, that it's I'm people are asking me to help them and I can't say no, and I've got appointments from 8 in the morning till 9 at night, for example. So getting to know my pleaser, I can then be more discerning about when to use it. And I might want to interview the opposite part, which might be the boundary setter. So the boundary setter might be, you know, I don't want to do this interview. You know, it's too many people here. It's too personal. You know, so the boundary setter can say no. And so get to know that energy. So getting to know your different selves, this is the idea. So somebody who's hearing a voice can sit here and speak from as a spokesperson for the voice. So the person can be asked questions. The voice, sorry, can be asked questions like, how long have you been in Jonathan's life? And what do you want for Jonathan? Why are you so angry with Jonathan? If Jonathan was different, would you be less angry? And we've done this, and it's great because it's nice for the voice hearer to have somebody else witness the kind of personality they're living with. So that's very acknowledging. Because one of the most difficult things about voices is that you're on your own with it. So it's a bit like, if it's a difficult relationship, it's a bit like experiencing domestic violence, but nobody else sees the husband who's beating you up. You know, so this brings out that relationship, so it's more accountable, more visible. So yeah, we'll take a break.